there have been great strides and progress made in our understanding of how brains change with age, whether that's because of age-related changes or because of diseases. The most common disease, of course, being that affects older aging brains is Alzheimer's disease. I thought I might just give you a little bit of distinction between those concepts and then tell you a bit about some of the work we're doing in that space. First of all, when I talk about an aging brain, what I'm talking about is a very particular way of studying a brain, namely, give me a group of people, like all of you in this room, examine each of you carefully, get rid of all those who have any kind of disease that affects cognition. What's left are those who you would say are just aging, if you will, and then follow you over time and look at how cognition changes. And the science in that space has shown us that with time, aging brains, independent of any disease as we understand it now, do have some changes, changes in what we call fluid intelligence, the ability to think fast, multitask, and process new information. In contrast, what we find as we age, our ability, our crystallized intelligence, the knowledge we've learned, actually stays the same, if not grows over time. We find in the aging brain that actually, as people age, they grow happier. There's sort of a myth that lingered sometime that, you know, older adults are depressed and grumpy and anxious. That's actually not the case. Older adults tend to be much more present-focused and positively emotionally biased. And that's the aging brain. The disease brain is when someone like myself picks up signs and symptoms of memory loss and after a careful exam arrives at a diagnosis. And the most common disease, of course, is Alzheimer's disease. There are other diseases, though, that affect the brain with aging, and a lot of overlap amongst those diseases. Where the field's going is we've made tremendous progress with understanding the molecular and pathophysiologic signals, if to use a big word, of what causes the brain to start to develop more than just changes in fluid intelligence, but actually disabling cognitive impairments. We're waiting now for experiments with drugs in clinical trials to show that if we intervene on the biomarkers with these drugs, that we can change the natural history of these diseases. And at our center, we have several clinical trials going on right now, testing drugs in either very mildly or even cognitively normal adults who have markers to suggest the pathophysiology of Alzheimer's in their brain. It holds a great promise that someday we could diagnose you before you're even ill, like we diagnose heart disease. And that's the promise we have. But of course, that promise creates some challenges, which is another stream of our research. I'll tell you, leave it at this. I have people in those clinical trials testing who have a high risk of developing Alzheimer's dementia who take a break from work to come in to get their infusion. Imagine if one of your colleagues at work told you, I've got to leave a little early here because I got to go off to the Alzheimer's trial. Thank you. So that's my point. I think I'll close with the other area of research that we're doing here, in addition to developing better ways to diagnose the disease, to treat the disease, is to figure out better ways to learn to live with the disease and address some of the emotional, social, and cultural challenges we face as we push these diagnoses into increasingly more normal and non-clinically significant stages. And when we will, it'll be a whole new different disease. It'll be a disease like hypertension or osteoporosis, but I would argue a disease with a very different social and cultural valence, because it's about the failing of the brain, not so much the brittling of the bone or the hardening of the arteries.